بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم جميعا. On behalf of the British Council and the Ministry of Culture, we welcome all of you to yet another Shakespeare Lives activity. Today is African Voices, African Words Under African Skies. We thank our sponsors, Dal Group and Khartoum International Community School. Thank you for allowing us this wonderful opportunity. And of course, our media sponsors, Capital FM. Can we hear for Capital FM? And our lovely designers from In The City magazine, thank you so much for amazing designs, thank you. We further welcome and thank and acknowledge all of you distinguished guests here with us today. Thank you very much for being here with us. And for those of you that are actively working on developing culture in Sudan through cultural development, we'd like to give you a special thank you. And we have with us here people like Mr. Manfred, the director of Goethe Institute, and they've been doing some amazing work here in Sudan. Can we please hear it for Goethe Institute? Not with us today, he apologized, but I'd like to give a special shout out and thank you to the ambassador of Italy, Mr. Fabrizio Rabosso, who's also been doing some amazing work here in Khartoum. Similarly, Mr. Nigel Winner, the principal of KICS International Community School, Khartoum International Community School, we thank you as well very much. And of course, our friends from the Social Partnerships Department of Dal Food and Dal Group, thank you all so much. Dal Cultural Forum, thank you so much. So, ladies and gentlemen, what we and all the performers have here in common, based on our theme of African voices, why did we choose that theme? Well, that theme is a direct result of the crippling identity crisis that is facing us here in Sudan. And all the racial and tribal issues boil down to one question: are we African or are we Arab? Well, I'm not even asking that question. I'm not even asking it. I'm just, you know? But what myself and all of the participants that are with us here today, what we all share in common is the simple fact that we feel that that question itself is the actual fitna in our community. Us asking that question is creating the fitna in and of itself. The question itself is irrelevant, it's immoral, it's divisive, and as a matter of fact, we all come from Sudan, and Sudan is the heart of Africa, so we have to embrace Africa. And finally, can you please welcome with me our brother from Somalia, from Canada, from Africa, Ahmed Ali, Knowmadic. To be with you, Ahmed, here in Sudan.
It's a pleasure to be here as well. Going back to the motherland from art is a beautiful thing, you know? SubhanAllah, so thank you for having me. It is an extreme pleasure to be here today and enjoy the African weather, the African food, which made my stomach upset because it was telling me, get rid of all the Canadian you have, Ahmed, and here's some Sudan. I was like, okay, fine.
Before I leave the stage, I recently told our guests here that how powerful the word is. And even when you don't understand it, and I remember calling you telling me a story that meant exactly that. Can you please tell our guest that story?
Yes. So the story falls back to a lot of times as Africans, we want to do art, and our parents are like, stop for luck, come on, engineering, pharmacy, Ahmed, doctor, come on, what are you waiting for? Right? And it falls back to that. But I know I told my mom, I said, Mom, I want to do poetry. It's good, it's halal, what I'm doing is not bad, and I love it. And she said, Ahmed, you know what? Please go into pharmacy. And then there was this one story that happened that really changed her mind. And before that, she was totally against it, but this is what happened. I wrote my mom a poem for Mother's Day. And my mom doesn't understand English, not fluently at least. And my poems contain a lot of metaphors. And so I wrote this poem for my mom and I shared it with her and she's like, what? I'm like, okay, fine. So one day I got invited to a Mother's Day event and they said, Ahmed, read your poem because a lot of the people in Canada enjoyed it, appreciated it, Edmonton. So I said, fine, I'll come out and present it. I'm like, may I please bring my mother? They're like, are you crazy? Please, bring your mother. So I said, great. So I brought my mother, and there were about 400 mothers at this event. No fathers, just mothers, celebrating mothers. So I said, all right, fine. I get up on stage, and I start reciting my mom's poem. And all the mothers around my mom started crying because they understand what I'm saying. My mother doesn't understand what I'm saying because she sees them crying, she started to cry. And it really moved her. And after that day, she's like, mashallah, Ahmed, continue. And the funny story is, in Alberta, we have a lot of oil. and there's this area called Fort McMurray where people to work oil, especially the newcomers. So I said, Mom, I'm going to Fort McMurray. She's like, stop for life. Why? What happened to poetry? I said, it's for art, Mom. She's like, Alhamdulillah. Yalla, yalla, go. Very good. So change your mind completely.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ahmed Knowmadic in the house.
Sorry about all those that have my forehead shining right back at you. I apologize. So much trade around here. Sudan has been fantastic, subhanAllah. Before I came to Sudan, you know, you have this image, and I make this comparison. I say that we're all artists. All of us, every single one are poets. Every single body, everybody in this audience is a poet. And the thing is, if you don't paint or if you don't create your own art, people will create it for you. As an African, people were creating what Sudan looked like. So when I was first coming here, I was telling my wife, should I hide my wedding ring? I don't want it to be stolen. And then I came here, I was like, what an idiot I am. Because people are wearing their wedding rings, and I see people, women driving cars, and from what I heard, they've been going to university since 1920s. Subhanallah, it blew my mind. I was like, this is the real Sudan. People who are telling us what Sudan or where Africa is false. So because I came here, you as artists created what the real meaning of Sudan was. And not only that, there are so many poets, so many rappers, so many musicians here. And it blew my mind because I never thought this was a reality, but it's an actual reality. And Alhamdulillah, I was amazed, and I am grateful that I got to see that, because now as an African, I can take this back and become an ambassador, and somebody, anybody says, oh, Darfur, my God, get out of here, Haywan. Sudan is way better than that. It's beautiful, it has a lot of beautiful people, although the roads are crazy, subhanAllah. It has a lot of beautiful people and a lot of beautiful culture. Fool was fantastic. I'm no fool, but I love the fool. Subhanallah, it's fantastic. So I really enjoyed it. And so I was born in Somalia, moved to Italy when I was 4 years old, and because we didn't have money, my dad is literally a nomad. He's still in Somalia right now. He's running around with camels and goats and livestock. That's what he does. He loves that. And I'm in the city. And so we moved to Italy. We had nothing. And so we had to stay at a boarding school with my family. The boarding schools were difficult because I'm a Muslim and the boarding schools were Catholic. And as a Muslim kid, very outspoken, as you can tell, they used to try to make me eat pork. And I used to be like, nah, I'm not eating no pork. Get out of here, right? And then they take the pork out of the soup and like, here, try this. I'm like, get out of here, I'm not eating that pork. And so I used to get beat a lot because I did not want to fit into the Catholic system, because although I appreciated their own religion, I had my own to carry. And as an individual, I believe we all carry our own unique identities, and that's what makes this earth beautiful. Our differences is what makes us unique, but also we should celebrate others' differences. That's what makes us unique, right? Eventually moved to Canada, and then I had to learn a brand new language. I forgot how to speak Somali while I was in Italy. I learned the English language when I went. It took me 5 years to completely master the English language. I lost Italian. I relearned my Somali language, and it's been difficult, but ever since, alhamdulillah, I've made poetry my main source of income, and it's been fantastic. Before I continue, I'd just like to say thank you. Thank you so much, Sudan, for having me here. Thank you to Kix, the British Council. Capital 91.6 FM for really supporting me and giving me that love and support, because if it wasn't for you guys championing me, I wouldn't be here on the stage. And to all the brothers and sisters who are thinking about art and thinking you can't do nothing, I came from Canada for art. That's what I came here for art. So subhanAllah, anything is possible. Please, if you believe in it, continue to do it and try to convince your parents. That's the hardest part. So my name, Knowmadic, people ask me, what does Knowmadic mean? It's spelled with a K-N-O-W-M-A-D-I-C. Because it's, I'm no longer running around with animals in Canada, or else I look like a refugee, right? So it's knowledge-based nomad. That's where the term comes from. And I actually wrote a poem for that, and it goes like this. I was born November 28th, 1984. It was a Wednesday. Aside, my mother said I was destined to hold the week together, but she told me to never become complacent, because success, she says, comes in Friday casual and never came in Monday blues. Now the moment I was born, my mother proclaimed me Ahmed, an Arabic name which is supposed to mean one who constantly thanks God. But ever since 9/11, it means sketchy welfare scam and immigrant terror piracy. You know what? That's it. Everybody, give me your attention. I have lessons and mass instructions, and I'm ready to blow all of y'all away with my talent. Because truthfully, I'm just an African trying to make it in the entertainment industry. Man, I barely blow things out of proportion. But let's take in a moment of silence how I can no longer take my career to the United States to blow up. How I'm unable to break into markets without being detained. How I can no longer hold your attention hostage without raising suspicion. Now, I know the name Ahmed doesn't encompass my history, and that is why I have adopted the name Knowmadic to carry my Somali tradition. It means knowledge-based nomad, because one of my grandfathers was a farmer, the other a nomad herding animals. I can be neither in the city, so I have adapted to planting ideas that feed thoughts and harvesting emotions while traveling and making a living off of words that are heard. Now, my mother jokes that even my words are nomadic because she said they're... Wow, complete. My mother jokes that even my word, my spirit is nomadic because she said even my words are moving. But the thing is, growing up, we couldn't afford toys. So I replaced them with endless amount of stories. And because I had nothing else, I played with monster truck metaphors and action hero alliterations and linguistics bars and my friends and family facilitated to further perfect my powerful punchlines. But it was my mother's gentle intellect that eased the understanding of how raising points is far more superior than raising fists, and how money has nothing to do with the process of becoming enriched. So now, I invest my time in people. And my grandparents may no longer be here, but I'll continue to embody their dreams. That means even if I had to enter the pen to start a sentence, I will write my way back into the world to finish the poem my grandfathers have started. So here I am, a nomad on a journey, trying not to settle with names like pirate, warlord, or terrorist. And it's obvious that my history is too rich for those poor in judgment. They're unable to digest my truth, so they throw up all these slurs. And I thought it would change with age, but I had to take my expectations to rehab because they were too damn high. And even though I try to sober them with thoughts, they continue to take shots. Now me, I may not be the king of beers, but I'm wiser, so I'll stick to my round of applause. If there's anything I've learned in these 3 years of life, that it's all about outlook. So word to Microsoft, I'm going to continue to excel until I reach my PowerPoint. Signing up. And so, when I was 16, my parents went back to Somalia. They said, Ahmed, we're gone. You didn't struggle enough. You don't understand what struggle is. You need to struggle. I said, SubhanAllah, why didn't we leave Somalia? That would have been a perfect opportunity for me to struggle. They said, Ahmed, you don't understand. Now, my father was very metaphorical, though. I know he didn't mean he wanted me to starve, but somehow he wanted me to starve, in all actuality. He meant it in a soulful way, and I didn't understand this. So they left when I was 16, took my two little brothers and two little sisters, and went back to Somalia. Now, I'm living in Canada, and I have my older brother with me, but he doesn't care about me. He honestly didn't. He had his own life, so he didn't care where I went or what I did. And so I went back to sleeping in shelters and eating from food banks. And it was difficult, right? Because as an African, this stuff is shameful for me. Because I don't want to eat from a food bank. I'm in Canada. This is the land of freedom and opportunity. But yet I was at food banks, and I was living at shelters. And it was unfortunate. And there was this one story that happened while I was in high school. There was this one of my friends whose name was Mike. He's Caucasian. And he's a good friend of mine. And so we were in the cafeteria with a bunch of us playing cards, and Mike is in the background playing music. And Mike turns his music loud because we were being really loud, so I understand. So I went up to Mike, I said, yo, Mike, please, can you turn down the music? He's like, all right, Ahmed, let me turn it down. Turns it down. Me and my friends start getting louder. And then Mike turns it up a little higher. My friend's looking at me like, ah, Ahmed, look, shame on you. You can't do nothing. You can't even stand up to your own friends. Look at you. So I went up to Mike, I'm like, yo, Mike, turn that down. Mike looks at me like, if you don't like it, Ahmed, go back to your country. And he calls me the N-word. And then I got upset because I have my friends that are influencing me. And at this point, I didn't have my own identity, so I was allowing my friends to create on me. So boom, I punched Mike. As soon as I hit Mike, his girlfriend ran to the office, called the principal. I got arrested and expelled from school that day. Now, my dad is in Somalia, and he doesn't know about this. And I'm scared he's going to find out about this. Now, the thing is, though, the officer waited until lunchtime to take me out of the school so that everybody could see me. And that's embarrassing for me because I was involved in the arts and I was involved in doing a lot of poetry and stuff in high school as well. And so the bell rings and everybody's looking at me like, oh man, I'm embarrassed. But then one of my friends who knows what I'm going through on the background sees me and he smiles. And then that made me smile because that was the point of comfort for me. And then the officer tightens my handcuffs and goes, you think this is funny? And then I wrote this poem for him. I was 17 when I got arrested. There was nothing cool about the moments that led to it either. I didn't get arrested for robbing a bank or anything cool like that. Now, I know what you're thinking. What's so cool about robbing a bank, Ahmed? Nothing. But as far back as I can remember, man, I always wanted to be where money made me feel like I didn't have to worry about walking 45 minutes to rest my head, where I no longer had to lie to my friends about having just eaten. But in that instance of me thinking about robbery and bank, thoughts of my dad promising to run across the ocean fast enough just to kick my ass across my mind. Now, my father was in Somalia at the time, but he could have been in another planet, but somehow he was never too far for a lesson. Always close enough to stress the importance of struggle and how struggle is the essence of success, and that success is much like a tree, you would say, because it takes a tree years to build branches with leaves big enough to fully appreciate sunlight. Everything that's worth something takes time, you would say. Now, my father would often stretch the truth to teach me a lesson, but he never lied, and this only helped solidify that smile carved on my face. And noticing my smile like handcuffed for me, the officer didn't hesitate to ask me if I thought this was funny. Now, Dave Chappelle and SpongeBob, that's funny. But this is more like a soap opera. A drama with each episode leading to more confusion. Sometimes, it doesn't matter who you are, it's hard to accept what is foreign. So how do I translate the weight of expectations placed on a 17-year-old Somali boy's shoulders who can barely carry his life in his wallet? Now at this moment, I'm assuming I'm either thinking of NWA or Martin Luther King, because before I could realize how badly my brain just trolled me, the words "F the police" escaped my mouth. And like a volcano, he erupted. His composure can be seen flying that way. His reasoning, flying that way. And over him, a thick cloud of superiority was growing, and his words, "You good for nothing," burned just like lava. Now, guilty until proven innocent, right? Yeah. He's just proven guilty for overlooking my innocence, so without hesitation, I apply damn right to the conversation. And then he handcuffs me tighter, not knowing this is a point of comfort for me. This is the closest I've got to embrace since my parents left when I was 16. These handcuffs aren't confined. My apartment is visited. Inside, you will find my jail cell. A naked apartment stripped of its youth. No television, no couches. I don't rest my head on a pillow, just a mattress and no record of sleep. When I brush my teeth, it's with watered down toothpaste. When I shower, it's with dish soap. Check the cabinets, there are no traces of dishes there. Just a pot of tea on the stove that whistles, reminding me that sometimes things are gonna get hot and I'm allowed to scream, but I should step aside and everything will be cool once again. So I have a Somali English rap for y'all. Cause Somalis are enemies, and if you don't understand, I'm sorry about that, but the Somali people, you know.
All right.
Some say hog, I think it's about the aqli. It's not about your talent, man, it's how you use your waqti. Cause if you're chasing droga and la'ag, you be a bakti. Up to either gay, so for you the nafti, the wa'ina udirasho. Her health first, shaka that them best, so no time to translate. Language is a mandate. If you did not faham, your adam might stagnate. And it's without question, your nigga won't impregnate. So chase your dreams by any means and make sure any way you aim, but never lose your language. Let's all pray that loving becomes a habit. Wealth for those who don't, and health for those who have it. Random fact attack. Did you know that Naira backward is a yan? And on the an or afteen la'an, and much like a shinny, I make what's my an. And word to all the jah heads, I'm hard as a nigga. With just one fade, it will feel like ko, level, sada. Each one with sound effects like nush, bah, wabah. Cause I come from a man where the law was the weapon. I'm told organic wasn't a question, you can find it in a second. But Abba took us out due to complications. Now we're Hakunala, had the land of First Nations. But remember way back in the day, we came to Canada saucer and wanted to play. Hoy wouldn't let us cause it was minus wow. I was gonna use the horror, couldn't find a rhyme, excuse me. I'm gonna use Angelica cause it's softer on the throat. But please call usually. Light all your own seeds and wave the smoke detectors. Shout out to Dakunasha and any gate of sectors. My name is Ahmed Ali, but a show an accent. If you have any shah, man, I'd really love to have some. I'll be the first to say that my office be on so-so, but until the day I die, well, Somali and so. For people, because they kept asking me, where are you from, where are you from, where are you from? And the thing is, as human beings, we are all from Africa, right? We all come from Africa. And no matter where we are, that's home. This is the motherland, but no matter where we go, that's home. You know what I mean? A lot of people, this identity crisis that we're going through, we are Africans, but our home is wherever we live. And so I got tired of people telling me this, and so I wrote them a moral, a poem, and inshallah, I'm gonna end it off with this. By the way, a quick question, how many people have Twitter here? I can see hands, actually, I got good eyes. If you have Twitter, you better follow me right now, or else there's gonna be a lot of trouble. No, but for real though, support is the biggest thing for an artist. If you have a friend that's an artist, support them. Because we go nowhere without support, and that's why I was saying thank you to Capital 91.6 FM for supporting me. That's why I was saying thank you to the British Council for supporting me, Kicks for supporting us. Because without other people, I know there's a word for support when you try to get something, but what's that word again?
What's
up? Yes, that's the word. That's what we need for each other. Because without other people, we wouldn't make it. We need each other, subhanAllah. And I wouldn't be here today if my mother didn't support me for my art, if my family didn't support me for my art, if the British Council didn't bring me, I wouldn't be here today. So please, if there is somebody doing art, support them. Support your radio stations, support your artists, support Nas with Notepad, support these people. These are the people that are making a difference. So inshallah, give support to art. Art makes difference, art changed lives. I left Somalia because of war, I returned to Sudan because of art, subhanAllah. Think about the beauty of that, so here we go. They asked me where I came from, I told them my mother's womb. The conception of my greatness for some is too much, but the birth of my artistry is a must. That's why there was never a plan B. But if they're dying to know, I was born in a land where the bullets fly free like the doves do, and regardless of how many beatings you get, your mama still loves you. A place where there are more straight bullets than cats, more koofies than hats, and if you don't have that lettuce, cheese, or bread, regardless if you got that beef, it's considered a rap. See, I've been chasing talent with success for many years, and I've been abusing it too. So if you were to call me a fameaholic, man, it'd be absolutely true. Because most days I wake up wishing I had me millions. Others, I'm grateful I'm up at all. But don't get it twisted, I still wish I had the Starbucks so I could live all grande. I'd never be short all money and I always stack it tall. Because money is dear to me. I've been chasing dough ever since I was a young buck. My philosophy's much more simple. Plant flowers wherever you go to grow. Remember that the future is in the youth. Power is in the hands of the people. Live to die old, but always fight to be equal. And if your lover asks for space, return with the universe in his place. A bouquet of galaxies and a ray of stars to light your ceilings at night. And if they act up, cut them from the script, because life is nothing but a sitcom. Some are there for a few seasons, a few are there for some episodes, and most are just extras in the background. And stay clear of those who hijack style, because theirs is too plain like 9/11, or the ones that stand on the corner of the block 24/7 like 7-Eleven. See, I used to have friends that behaved like pennies, and I was having none of it. They didn't change, so I got rid of them like the Canadian government. But I pray that I never forget that it's the light that creates the shadows, and that even stars need darkness to shine, and that we are nothing more than matter made of earth and time, and in a matter of time, this body of ours will go back to earth and will matter, because in a world where a legacy is the only thing you can leave behind, it's not when you enter your grave, but when the last memory of you fades that you die. After all, there's a reason why Allah shaped this earth like a honeycomb, is so that we may never forget to just be. Thank you very much, Khartoum. Y'all have been fantastic. I've enjoyed it. Inshallah, tomorrow I see the pyramids. I also found out that the oldest pyramids and the most pyramids are in Sudan. We gotta tell travel tourists, we gotta change this, man. We gotta change this, subhanAllah. We gotta let them know that this is where it's at. And inshallah, as an ambassador, because I've gained so much knowledge here, I'm gonna take this back with me. I'm gonna share all this knowledge with everybody. Inshallah, I'm gonna create a poem specifically for this experience, because subhanAllah, Sudan has been fantastic, has been beautiful. Alhamdulillah, thank you very much.